Okay, hello. Welcome back. I hope you were able to take care of yourselves during our break. Do what you need to do for nourishment, rest, relaxation, exercise, all the things, all the good things. And here we are again. So yeah, just want to remind us that we are recording. So in the feedback tonight, the harvesting from the community agreements, if you'd rather not be recorded, you could just turn your camera off at that time if you want to contribute, or contribute in the chat, but not raise your hand. And just to say a bit about the shape of the evening, so actually I'll get the PowerPoint back up for a sec here. Where is it? Somewhere in amongst all these slides. Here we are. So here we are at the welcome. And in a minute, I'll be handing over to Balajit and he'll lead us in an arriving practice. And then Viveka will help us harvest from, I said community agreements, but that wasn't right. It was harvesting from the small group discussions we had earlier about ways of working with emotion. And then we're going to do some movements just to get the body moving, get the juices flowing a bit, a meditation. So Balajit will lead the movement, Viveka will lead the meditation, and then we'll end with an intention setting ritual. And I'll say more about that when we get there. So there'll be an opportunity for us to set intentions for how we want to show up for the rest of the retreat, or energies that we want to call in to support us on the retreat. So I think that's all for now. I will hand over to Balajit now to get us going with a little arriving practice.
Thank you. Thanks, Singhasri. Hello, everybody. Yeah. So we're going to the invitation is just to come into a felt touch contact with your ears. Just see how it is, just to give them a gentle massage. So this is a really simple exercise that gently stimulates the parasympathetic nervous system. I saw a coach at might have been the Olympics or Commonwealth Games just before his athlete had their performance, just gently massaging the person's ears. I've remembered it ever since. So yeah, just noticing what that feels like. And just relaxing. So now we're going to do a little bit more self-touch. So this is one way I see this is working directly with the nervous system. So the nervous system is very sensitive to the touch of others and self-touch. So taking one hand, doesn't matter which one, and then see if you can just place it on the back of your head, I think. Yeah, and anatomical term is the occiput, right at the back of the head there. So this is approximately where the reptilian brain hangs out, which can give us our quite dramatic shifts in physiology into fight, flight, and freeze. So we're just holding that. And then with the left hand, we're going to place that in the area of the prefrontal cortex. So this is the higher executive functioning that easily goes offline with fight, flight, and freeze. That's it. Just placing that hand on the forehead and sensing. Just noticing what the body felt, senses of this touch. Any shift in the breathing, temperature, energy levels, mood, energy. So we'll give the arms a little bit of a break there, and then just seeing if you can place the right hand on the forehead, and now the left hand, or it could be the other way around, in the heart area. And once you've sensed this for a while in the heart area, you might like to explore just making some little micro adjustments, just to see if there's more resonance with the touch in a slightly different position on the chest, either higher or lower or left and right. In a way, finding where this touch seems to most communicate with the body. These sort of exercises can help the body get more of a sense of itself, so encourage a sense of integration and connection, as well as fostering some sense of safety. But we're all very different, so just sensing how it is for you. And then finally, you might like to just take the hand off the forehead and then place the hand on the belly. So here we're bringing touch to our two prominent feeling center areas, the core energy emotional centers of the torso. And again, with the belly, seeing if you can find a place that feels most interesting or resonating. And sensing, sensitive to the whole body. And if you like, you might like to experiment here with what's sometimes called intentional touch. So it might be that you may like to have the intention that the touch is kindly awareness, or I'm here, or you're not alone, whatever might work for you. And then from here, just in your own time, relaxing the arms. And I'll pass over to Viveka.
Right. Thank you. Balajit, as we're doing that, I was... reminded of, just as I was preparing for what we did this earlier session, which was look at different approaches to working with emotion from the Buddhist tradition, some of the traditional primary ways of working with emotion. There was something about mindfulness that I was appreciating. So just to remind those of us that maybe we're here for this, and then also just help weave in those of you that are arriving. I just want to remind you that whether this is your first time, or you've been at everything, or you've been to some things, you are enough and it's all good. Yeah. So just to say that. And this is what we were doing before. There were three approaches. Yeah. One, a mindfulness approach where we're creating a space where we're intentionally saying, in this practice, I'm not in my normal activity, and creating a space of becoming aware of what's happening, bringing in a helpful way an observation of what's happening as I also experience it. So rather than being only lost in experience, there's also the ability to observe it or have a wider awareness of what's happening. So that was one technique. And one thing I was appreciating about that relates a little more to the neuroscience of things is that sometimes in mindfulness, we use labeling of experience, right? Like it might be as broad as, oh, I'm feeling some kind of way. We put the feeling wheel into the Padlet, and maybe Daiketu, you could remind people where resources are, the links. But there's a wheel of different feelings that we put in the Padlet, and you can use that to get a little more nuanced about, oh, what am I feeling? You know, and we can sort of name emotions, and being able to name them can really help us make more sense of our emotions. And so what I love about the feelings wheels, it's this amazing rainbow display. It's literally in rainbow colors, rainbow display of all the different emotions. But what I find interesting, or shall I say, what I find interesting with that is labeling brings on that prefrontal cortex. It brings on reason and logic. So if we're in a swirl of emotion with no clear understanding, labeling can bring that executive function in, so we have more choice. And I think the interesting thing with that is how to also, the skill of having the clarity and the feeling actually beginning to get more simultaneous with them, right? So just because we're clear and the prefrontal cortex, that reasoning and logic part of us is alive, that doesn't just actually dominate and take over the feeling body, actually having its say, that the fact that it actually exists and has been feeling all along. So I just think that's a really interesting, I love the integration you're doing, right? That we can have our clarity, our to make wise choices, activated helpfully, and we can have the feeling integration as well. So they're working cooperatively, and that to me is a lot of the kind of skill we can develop if we really come into relationship with our emotions. Okay, so the second approach we looked at, just as a reminder, is that as well as just being in mindfulness and letting experience unfold, learning that we don't have to identify with it, noticing its changing nature, you know, impermanence in classic terms, right? There can be a calming as well as a wisdom about, there's this just unfolding lawfully on the basis of conditions, all of this, yeah? We talked about a second major gift from Buddhist teaching is that all the teachings about how to tend to the experience. So actually getting a bit more involved with it, emotion, especially we're talking about when emotions are agitating us or really presenting in a way that there's like ripple effects from them. We contend with antidotes, things like, even what we just did. Intentional touch, kind touch to sadness or grief. Yeah, it's more like antidote, tending. Yeah, anxious energy, feel the earth, that kind of thing. And the third way, which in a way mindfulness and creates a portal to this even deeper engagement. So rather than remaining more disinterested in a mindful sense, we could actually really go even drop in even further. You know, we can drop from the thinking mind separated from the body. We can drop into the body being with the thinking mind sensation. And we can drop even further into feeling the raw, naked sensation, the energy. Moving farther and farther away from what we make of the energy and all the fabrications and constructions, and sort of just like letting that release and like going deeper into the heart of the naked experience, you could say the raw experience. And in that way, approaching reality directly. Just who are we really? What is happening really? Just the flow of energy in the open dimension of space, a boundless space of awareness, always there in itself, having a loving nature because it's not rejecting, judging experience. It just, there's just, what shall we say? You know, the mystery, I think Balajit used the phrase mystery before. What shall we say about it? And in a way, that's the ultimate antidote. You know, like if you say, I like the antidotes, like for the poison of wisdom, of ignorance, you could say that this turning towards the deeper engagement, just being deeply with experience is the ultimate antidote. It's wisdom. It's like not having to fix anything. Yeah. So all three are very helpful. Okay, so that's the quick summary. is there anything, Balajit or Singhashree, you want to say about that that you think might be helpful at this point before we just hear back from the groups?
No, I'm okay right now. Thanks.
Okay. You are okay. Thanks for letting us know that. Balajit, are you, anything coming to you, or you at peace?
I'm just wondering, Viveka, if you, I'm going to pass it back to you here, actually, instead of say something else. I'm just wondering, could you say a little bit more about, you know, the deepest antidote is wisdom, you know?
Yeah, I know, so that's provocative a little bit, yeah. So the thing about attending with antidotes, is it really, we need to, it's very helpful to have antidotes, yeah? If we're, if an emotion is disturbing enough that it's actually making it hard for us to be in our intention, be in our creativity, yeah? So it can be very helpful. And sometimes we call it, in somatics, resourcing ourselves, yeah? So if everything's unstable, it's very hard just to be a human. It's just very hard. It's a lot to bear. It's a form of suffering, yeah? So we can resource ourselves to be more stable. So like with each of the, you know, we talked about the five primary emotions that can disturb us from the Buddhist tradition. So the first three are very classic, show up in all of Buddhism as greed or attachment, hatred and delusion. And then the Vajrayana adds also pride and jealousy. Yeah, just one system. And with each of those, there's ways to antidote them. Yeah, like meaning help address, bring them into balance or address what's harmful about them in the moment. So there's this like temporary pacification or temporary quelling or soothing. But it really, it's wisdom that's gonna get at the root. We talk about getting at the root of the whole cycle, these dynamics, yeah? So if we, let's just take an example of, let's say certain people that I'm like very close, intimately close to, let's say my in my family circle, sometimes people like in that closeness can say something to me, like give me some feedback, and that can, I can really I can tend to bristle at that. There's something about the intensity, like maybe of relying on that relationship for love or something, right? So that it's very, it feels really ouchy. I'm very sensitive. So I can antidote that. I can breathe. I can take space before responding. But if it keeps coming up, keeps coming up, keeps coming up, I haven't really gotten to the root of it. You know, if every time it's the same cycle, it's the same cycle, it's the same cycle. So there's different ways to get at the root of it. You know, some of them use more reflection and understanding, like contemplating the conditionality of it, you know, like, so through clarity of understanding the situation, that's one way to release the dynamic. And I would say there's lots of really amazing therapies out there that are very helpful for that. And so that's more on the cognitive side. On this, what we're suggesting here is a little different. It's an aspect of working with our embodiment to actually, we're penetrating through to like the illusion of there being a solid threat, like the basic existential setup. Yeah. That somewhere in here is a threat. In a way, then, like underneath, there's like layers of emotion we may go through, actually. When we turn towards the emotion, this third way of being with it, we may discover that, for example, underneath anger, there could be fear. Yeah. So we're getting through like these like layers of our vulnerability, really, to like a very core level of our vulnerability. Yeah. And so when those things that we're unconsciously and very habitually protecting, like if we go and look, we can get into really a direct realization and experience that of our the confidence of being deeply okay at an sort of an existential level. Yeah. And I'm cautious here because I don't want to say that there is still the material level that still matters. So I could be very deeply okay at an existential level. And we might still need to work on anti-Asian hatred so that I don't have to worry about being like, you know, physically harmed when I got my door. Right? So on the material level, it doesn't eradicate the material level, but the material level can be great. And if existentially we're still operating with this insecurity around having to be in a, having to defend our life at some very deep existential level, you know, there's no amount of external conditions that are going to end dukkha suffering in that way. So this is what we mean by this type of freeing up is what Buddhism is ultimately trying to open the way for. So the ultimate antidote is wisdom, it's understanding. As I experience the raw sensation and the field of openness, I'm directly experiencing the unlimited potentiality in a way of speaking of that energetic expression. And the ceaseless emotion stops being a threat, like this, oh, could this just stop? It's not that anymore. It's like, please stop feeling, right? That no, it just, we talked about this before, like, wow. Like all that sensitivity becomes the aliveness of, this human instrument, that phrase, Singhasriva, that phrase from a friend, yeah, this human, it's like, and in the Vajrayana, we do use that language is heard, self as an instrument, the energy for compassionate activity in our world. Sangha actually very much talked about the going from integration to positive emotion, to receptivity, to like a loss of a spiritual death in the sense of, oh, everything I thought I had to protect is like not really there. And then the spontaneous compassionate activity. That's a system of meditation in Triratna, if that's helpful to map to. So I hope that's helpful. Balajit, is there something else you're thinking about that? Yeah. Okay. Yeah, they're like, oh, it's like, I'm okay. And it would be great if we were all like able to say deeply existentially, I know I'm okay. Like, I'm really okay. That'd be great. Thanks. Okay, let's hear what's coming up from the groups. Yeah, shall we make that shift? So I'm wondering, people could use raise hands, and it's just a chance to share what's alive in relationship to this. Yeah. And we can, even if you weren't in a group, we get to benefit from what we're sharing here. Yeah. So if you would raise your hand, or you could chat something you want to bring in now. And just to say, I'll ask if you're up for engaging around it more. And if you are, then we might ask if you're okay with coming on screen with me. And you can always engage with me without the camera as well. So let's just take a moment to see people can chat or raise their hand. What's coming up for you around just what does it spark for you about how are you working with emotion? What's the learning edge for you? What's resonating here? And we also, we have a lot of comments in the Padlet too. Just seeing if there's anything fresh people want to bring in. Okay, I'm just gonna, as Singhasri said, there's a lot in the Padlet. So I think to be able to move into some practice, what you wanted to do, I will just share a little, just bring out a little bit of what's here. So, you know, people are just noticing the different things that they do. We see there's people noticing, oh, I am pushing things down. Yeah. And then there's lots of practices people have for working with themselves, which is really great. So I encourage people to look. Maybe that will spark some ideas for you. You know, practices like focusing and writing, and how someone works, like I try to balance between staying with the emotion in the body and doing something that might sometimes help shift the energy of difficult emotions. Yeah. So, Gita was speaking to that really beautifully too about, it's moving. I can kind of move with it. Yeah. So finding that kind of dance. And so people are uncovering it, maybe like just noticing what tendencies we have, right? Tendencies to be willful when working with emotions, which lead to unskillful blame, shame. It's helpful to pause and get curious. So just noticing, is there a subtle aversion trying to get emotions to go away? Again, people bring up the pause. There's a very important pause. Yeah, there's a very important pause. I struggle to pause much of the time, and that prevents me going deeper. Yeah. And also not pausing to actually feel. So I can let go of the challenging emotions easily, but I can also miss being aware of the feelings, right? So this is really great noticing.
Great, thanks, Viveka. Okay, so we have a space now to do some mindful movement. So this is the first time we've done mindful movement on this retreat, and we'll be peppering the rest of the retreat with mindful movement. I'm going to move my chair out of the way and reposition my camera and stand back. So I'm going to do this standing, but if for whatever reason you don't want to or it's difficult to stand, then it's fine to sit down. You can join in sitting down as well. So I'm going to try and reposition my camera so you can see me, but it doesn't show my rather lurid Christmas socks.
You're muted, Balajit.
Yeah, thank you. So can you hear me now? Great.
Yes.
Okay, so there's no circus acts here or Olympian gymnastics, not today anyway. It's just very, very simple movement. And the movement's going to focus on just bringing activity to the joints. So we're just going to start by just rotating our hands and bringing some movement to the wrists. So often there's some stiffness or lack of range in the joints. And that tension can easily restrict the flow of prana or life force. So in a way, we're working on the mind through the body here. The body, the mind is so conditioned by the physiology of the body. So just, so here the invitation is not just to do the movement and not be present, but to actually feel the movement of the hands and the fingers through space. So what science calls proprioception. And then from there, we'll just take the arms out and then placing the hands into these little kind of beaks like that. And then just a very simple movement. See if you don't tense the shoulders, if you can. And then we're just going to do a very simple, relaxed touching the top of the shoulders. And the invitation here is to find your own pace here. So I'm finding my pace. Invitation is to find your pace. And again, see if you can actually have a sensual experience of this. So feeling any resistance in the air as you move, coolness on the palms, that little light touch of the shoulder tops, and the sense of these limbs moving through space. And then from there, we'll just go directly ahead and we'll just, that's it, great, finding your own pace. So there's a lot of research in science at the moment around how proprioception deepens what they call interoception, what we might call body awareness. And then from there, the more familiar motion of the hips. Don't want to leave the hips out, because especially with a lot of sitting, there's so much tension here. And again, finding your own pace and way of moving with your own flexibility and limitations. In sensing if this feels kind of pleasant or unpleasant or neutral or a blend. That's it, gradually coming to standing. And feeling the support of the floor, the ground beneath you. And here, sensing how your weight is distributed on your feet. So what is your habitual way of standing in this moment? Is the weight more going back to the heel, or is it more in the ball, or is it more balanced? So just noticing. And then as we stand here, can you sense the little micro movements the body is making. So this is the vestibular system, involuntary system, assessing balance and doing these minor corrections. So it's, I find it almost impossible to stand completely still. Always this subtle wavering that we can become aware of. So this next movement is a bilateral, what's called sometimes a bilateral movement. So let me go even lower there. Good. So this is a coordination between the left and the right side of the body. Hopefully you can see me okay. So you've got the right palm of your hand. Now I'd like you to imagine that there's a piece of string in the middle of your right palm connected to your left knee. And that when you raise the right hand, the left knee is lifted up. Yeah. So if you just practice this motion. It's a kind of puppet motion. And then seeing if you can move from left to right. So almost as if you're kind of doing a funny walk. This always brings back 70s puppet TV programs that I grew up on. For me. And again, finding your pace for this final session of the day. How do I want to move now? What kind of pace do I want to move? And you might notice here, you know, that the ankle joints involved, the knee joints involved, the hip joints involved, the elbows are involved. So it's a multi-joint movement. So if your energy is feeling quite high and anxious, it might well be you've got fight and flight energies. And this is a good way to discharge some of that energy by doing this quite quickly. I'm not suggesting you do that now. But if you think fight and flight energies are designed to be discharged through the limbs. So this is a very limbs movement. So it's can be used in different ways to regulate the nervous system. And then we'll just gently stop there and sense, feeling the connection with the ground. And now in the final stage, it's just opening the eyes and once again allowing a slow, relaxed, curious orienting of the space you're in. Noticing how it feels as you do this. as we come back to the sense of the ground beneath us. And then from here, moving at your own pace into a 10-minute period of 15-minute period of meditation.
Well, I did send you a little chat about timing there.
So just finding your posture and support. So how is it to be sitting here now? The ground supporting us, holding our posture. So now we just have an open period of practice, I'll ring the bell at the end. So in a minute, I'll ring the gong to mark the end of this sit. And I'll pass over to Singer Shri, who's going to wrap us up for the day.
Thank you so much, Balajit. I don't know if those movements are designed to do this to me, but I just felt really plugged into the earth just then. Boom. Yeah, it was really good. Thanks. So much so that my conceptual mind is moving very slowly, but maybe that's a good thing because my intention is to take it slow. So looks like the body's following that intention. So yeah, we're gonna end this second day of our retreat with an intention setting ritual. And I'll just say a little bit about what I mean by intention setting. And then there'll be just a short space to reflect. And then we'll have a beautiful mantra from Mahasukha, who's an order member here in the UK, who's a musical type. And it's recorded these quite lovely mantras, all sorts of different mantras. And we'll share the resource in the Padlet as well. So and during the mantra, there's an invitation if you'd like to share your intention for the retreat in the chat. That would be lovely just to see what intentions we're setting for ourselves. It's okay if you don't have an intention yet or you don't want to share it, but it's just an invitation. So I've increasingly found the practice of setting intentions so powerful. There's something really alchemical about sort of really being clear about how we want to show up or what qualities we want to draw on. And we can imagine drawing those qualities from all sorts of different places. They could be coming from an imagined external source, like a Buddha or a Bodhisattva or a person who inspires us or nature or a pet or a piece of music. It could be anything, art. Or it might be that we draw on qualities maybe that we're just starting to discover within ourselves and we want to cultivate. Well, there's a both and there, isn't there? Could be that it's a little bit of both coming from the outside and the inside, meeting somewhere in the middle. So qualities we want to call on, cultivate. An intention could be a question you're holding, that you're just sort of rolling over in your mind, kind of like how we roll a stone over in the palm of our hand. So we're just holding it. We're just noticing what happens in our system as we hold that question in our hearts. Or it might just be a word, just like one word. Like mine's, my one word is slow. Actually, I've got two words, soft and slow. And the alchemy of intentions is that when we remember them, particularly when we're maybe experiencing a moment of duress. Yeah. So something's happening that the nervous system's maybe a little bit dysregulated, or we're agitated, or we're confused, or we feel like we've lost the plot, or we don't have any more strategies. An intention when we remember our intention, it can support something else to happen. Yeah. So there's an alchemy to bringing the intention into relationship with what's happening now, particularly when what's happening now may be challenging. And then something else maybe can happen. So so there's a power to intentions. There's a momentum there. And there's an energy that we can rest back in no matter what's happening. So I'm just going to invite us to have a quiet moment of reflection. There's been a lot of input already over the first few sessions of this retreat, so I'm sure things are bubbling up for you. So just thinking or maybe feeling into what intention you'd like to set for yourself on this retreat. In a moment, I will begin the mantra, and feel free to chant along. I'm sure many of you will recognize this. We're gonna have the Shakyamuni mantra, and one of the things we can also bring to mind, particularly if you're a visual learner and maybe you enjoy visualizing in meditation, is that particular mudra of touching the earth. And we can imagine we're touching the earth with our intentions, so we're sort of bringing all of our previous practice to bear on this moment that the earth has witnessed and holds for us. Seeing what magic might happen as we move forward together on this journey this week. So the mantra is a little less than 4 minutes long. So if you're worried about time, no worries. We're not gonna do a sevenfold puja right now. Just the mantra and the invitation to put your intentions in the chat. And do also feel free to make offerings if you've got a shrine there at home with you, assuming you're at home. You might not be at home, but do feel free if you do have a shrine there to make offerings during the mantra.
Om Muni Muni Mahamuni Shakyamuni Swaha. 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 Om Muni Muni Mahamuni. 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 Shakyamuni Swaha.
Thank you for your intentions, and thank you for your practice and your presence and your deep wisdom. And we look forward to seeing you in, I don't know how many hours. I do know how many hours. In 13 hours. So whatever time zone that means for you, you can do the math. And have a good evening. Feel free to unmute yourself or make reactions to say goodbye. And yeah, do feel free to keep filling the chat with your intentions. We're going to save that and put it in the Padlet. Bye-bye, go well.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.